Welcome back everyone to the lecture about Applied Bioimage Analysis. This part will be about multidimensional image processing in Fiji. So first of all, one of the masterpieces developed in ImageJ and Fiji are virtual stacks. So a virtual stack is basically a stack which is loaded on demand. So it just loads the part of the data which is necessary in order to look at the particular, for example, time point or Z-plane you're looking at the moment. And this is how it works. You take your original folder, you drag and drop it on ImageJ Fiji, and you have to activate this checkbox here. This is how you can activate this kind of mode. And then you will see your data set. So for example, this one here, I will just zoom in, is 32 gigabytes large, and 32 gigabytes don't match in the memory of my laptop. So I can look in data which is larger than my memory by using virtual stacks. And you will see always this V here in behind the brackets of the file name. That's quite important because you cannot do all the operations you want to do with virtual stacks. Just think about it. If you want to do maximum projections of all the time points, you have to actually open all the time points. So you can do a maximum projection to a virtual stack, but if the virtual stack is 3 terabytes large, then these maximum projections will take a week. So that's why if you work with virtual stacks, be a bit careful depending on which operation you are then actually afterwards doing on it. What you should do, depending on how your data is shaped, you should use a menu called Image Hyperstacks, Stack to Hyperstack, in order to convert the originally loaded stack. So it shows here, it looks like a three-dimensional dataset because you see a single bar here on the bottom. And you have to convert it from 33,000 slices to a given number of slices and frames in order to have these two bars down here and be able to browse through this dataset in space and in time. And you can compute these numbers, and I think I will later on show how to do this. Then afterwards, you can open and look through this dataset with the normal ImageJ viewer. But you can also use the so-called Big Data Viewer, which allows you to have in a more convenient way some tilting views on this data set. So for example, you can have certain perspectives on it, so you can tilt it like with orthogonal views we showed last time, but freely rotating, you can rotate the view. And there's quite some shortcuts related to the Big Data Viewer. The most important one maybe is F1. Which opens a window telling you about all the other shortcuts. I can definitely recommend Control Z, Control X to go into the certain orthogonal planes to find some way of orienting in these data. I would like to demonstrate how this is working. So you find here that's actually an external hard drive, not a fast SSD or anything. So this is a normal drive. And you find here, I have here a TIFF folder, which contains 2,900 files, which are each something like 100 megabytes large. So this is definitely more than what would fit in my computer memory. And in order to also show you how long loading takes, I will just turn on the clock. So I will now drag and drop my TIFF folder here. And it asks me if I want to open it as virtual stack. I think this checkbox is usually turned off by default. I have it on because I'm using this tool quite often. So, and I will now just click on yes. And it is actually going through all the files, but it is not loading them. It's just looking if these files have the right size. So I will speed up this video, this recording a little bit, but so that you believe me that it's really just taking a minute, you can watch here on the... So it did load my 2,950 files, which are apparently 320 gigabytes large. In a minute or in less than a minute. So this is doable technically. Then depending on with which kind of format you work, you may see here that this has a certain brightness contrast problem. So I will just click on auto here. And when you then go through these planes here, you will realize that all the TIFF images in this folder have been concatenated to a single bar. So that's what I was mentioning earlier. We have to now convert our image stack into a hyperstack in order to be able to view it correctly. And you can do this with the Image Hyperstack Stack to Hyperstack menu. And it tells us now that there are 300,000 slices. And you can, with a simple calculator, And you can, with a simple calculator, calculate what are the correct numbers for this, for the numbers we have to enter here. So I will now take the 300,000 files and I will divide them by the number of files in this folder. So that's 2,957. I can actually enter 2,957 already in frames, because this is how many time points we have. And if I divide the original number, I get out how many slices per stack we have. And when I now click on OK, so also this takes no time, yeah. And then I can actually go through Z and through time individually. And while I'm holding this button here, and while we see this embryo developing, it's over and over loading individual TIFF files from my external hard drive. So it's like, this is not cached in memory. I don't have 300 gigabytes in memory. Nevertheless, I can have a look at my embryo data set without going through a powerful computer with a lot of memory and a fast hard drive. So this is just doable, and I would say it's technology which is something like 10 years old or even 20 years old. It was always part of ImageJ. What is pretty more recent is the Big Data Viewer. So if we go to the plugin menu, and here you find the Big Data Viewer, you can open the current image in the Big Data Viewer. Yeah, also the Big Data Viewer has this time bar here on the very bottom, which allows you to take a look at certain time points. Furthermore, you can zoom in with Control Shift in the mouse wheel. You can, with a right click, pan your data set. And furthermore, and that's the actual cool thing, you can tilt with the left mouse click. You can tilt it in certain directions. So we are now leaving the XY plane, we are going in any random pseudo plane. And you zoom in now even further, you can also see here these stripes are actually stripes between different Z-planes. And so you see here what was kind of actually recorded, what was saved on your hard drive. And by pressing the I key and turning interpolation on and off, you can make this effect more or less go away. So this is very convenient if you want to take a look at your embryo, at your three-dimensional data set in arbitrary directions. And again, we are looking at here at a 300 gigabyte data set on a laptop with 16 gigabytes of memory. And this all comes just with Fidji. So it's not like you have to download additional plugins. This comes with Fidji, and you can already study embryo development. We did this last week already, maximum projection. So of course, if you loaded such a data set and you want to see from a certain perspective how the embryo is developing, of course you can do maximum projections. I'm just saying, if you do this with a virtual stack, it may take some time until these data sets are generated, but you can just do that with the same menu as shown last week. So this image stack C project, process all frames, and then you get a video like this where you can have a first look at how the embryo is developing. Furthermore, a pretty cool tool to visualize, for example, development. You take your maximum projection and you do a cylinder maximum projection of that. I show in a bit how this works. And then you can afterwards do some color coding of the positions in Z. So basically you take this data set, you use this color coding over time, and then you get these lines here which show you the trajectory of where the nuclei were moving. And the color basically expresses the time point when this thing was observed in this particular position. And also this tools like that allow you in a single two-dimensional image comparing different animals, different species, where are nuclei moving, from which direction, and so on. So with a single look in a two-dimensional image, you can see a process happening in four dimensions. You can also use the color coding in Z. That is basically the same tool. We are abusing a tool which is usually used for visualizing processes in time, but we use it for processing in space. So you see here that there are some nuclei which are yellow, so they are on the very back in this particular case, because you see here a slice number 151, so this is on the back. And you see on the front that there is also some structure, which is at the end also just nuclei. So you see basically color coded composition in Z with the same tool. We are using temporal color code for spatial color code. And furthermore, I introduced you to the concept of chymographs, and chymographs you can also just draw with a tool you know already, called dynamic reslice. So you draw a line and you will start dynamic reslice, and then you can see already the chymograph of your original dataset. If your chymograph looks like this, that you have this very small image, it may just have something to do with the fact that the pixels are not configured correctly, or that the pixel size you have to increase just to make the chymograph more interpretable. So change the pixel size in Z to get a better chymograph out, and then you will get these views I showed you earlier, and you can then basically go through your data set a bit more conveniently in order to study what is happening. So this is basically a recap of last week, reslicing. So we start from our embryo, we see it in this particular plane, and we are now reslicing it from the top in order to see this embryo in a circle shape from plane to plane. So again, we will assume that this is a cylinder, that the embryo has the shape of a cylinder. And you can also do this from different perspectives, and basically that's just a reminder of what we did last week. Now, starting from this particular image by drawing a line here, you can ask ImageJ to rotate this line around the embryo and take individual new images out of that. So you start the image stacks ready, the slice tool, and you also see what it is doing, because it will draw these lines in the order how it is actually processing the data set. And then you get a new stack out where these two-dimensional images here correspond to the pixel intensities along this line and in Z of this particular stack. Sometimes, at least in my data, brightness contrast has to be adapted. Then you can actually see how these images, which were originally taken from rotations inside the embryo, starting at the center, going to the outside, how they look like as a stack. And you can start from these projections, of intensities rotating around the center, and tilt, reslice this stack again. Then you will get a stack out of looking like this. It is a stack which starts in the very center of the embryo and goes to the outside. And when you do a maximum projection of such a stack, you basically get the nuclei sitting on the surface of this embryo. You get them in a two-dimensional image. And with some additional background subtraction, you can also make these nuclei with a higher contrast better visible. So in order to do this dimensionality reduction, or to reduce a three-dimensional data set to two dimensions, there is quite some work involved, and you have to think about different projections and reslicings from different perspectives in order to do a quite complex operation like this one. That brings us to the exercises. I would like to ask you to do this. So you download the Drosophila dataset from last week, actually, it's in the folder of last week, and you do these reslicings in the steps I just showed. You also find them here on the left. So it's reslicing from the top, radial reslice, and reslicing from the left. And then you do a maximum projection. You can do this in ImageJ Macro, and you can do this in CLIJ. I would assume that on a graphics card it's faster. Furthermore, try with and without background subtraction to get a bit of feeling of why we are doing this. And I would like to keep the exercises a bit short this time, because I would like to prepare a recap for the semester. And therefore, I'm asking you, this is an exercise. I'm asking you, go through your notes of this semester and write down what you did not understand, or where you would like to learn more about, and write it in the anonymous question board until July 3rd, because then I will make the slides for the final lecture, where I do some summary, and I can answer your questions there if you tell me the questions in time. With that, I can summarize that there are many dimensions. It's not just space and time and channels. We have to take also other aspects of data into account, and maybe it's not correct to call them dimensions. Maybe it's sample species, experimental conditions, and quantitative information, but they bring additional challenges to the image analyst, And that's why we have to think about potential solutions in order to reduce the amount of pixels we process. So there's like cropping in space, downsampling, cropping in time, reducing temporal resolution in time. So basically in space and time, you can do the same thing. So this is the same operations here. Projections, cumulographs make a lot of sense. And if nothing helps anymore, you have to process images in tiles and you have to switch to other file formats in, for example, these pyramidal file formats. Coming up next will be a very short session about image registration. I also would like to share this part and then a summary about the whole semester. See you soon.